Good evening and thank you for joining us. I'm Gilma Avalos. Rapper DMX and his legacy remembered across the tri-state today. From Westchester to Brooklyn, his impact on full display. A motorcycle procession rolling out this morning from Yonkers Raceway around noon, making its way across Westchester and into the Bronx. It was led by a monster truck with the words "Long Live DMX" carrying a red coffin, a nod to the rapper's bold style.
Josh Pittman at Lincoln Air Park on Saturday. Big Josh, Spider Josh, Little Josh, a plethora of Joshes gathered from all over the country to compete in the ultimate showdown.
I'm coming from Minnesota.
I'm coming all the way from Dallas.
So I'm from Omaha.
I'm from Wichita, Kansas. I drove 4.5 hours to be here.
And of course, the man who started it all, Josh Swain of Arizona.
I'm feeling pretty insane right now. It's kind of out of body right now. I honestly couldn't really tell you. I have probably a billion thoughts going through my head at the moment.
A year ago, Swain took to Facebook and challenged as many Josh Swains as he could to a battle royale. The winner would earn the right to keep the name. As the idea went viral, Swain decided to use the opportunity to contribute to charity, the Lincoln Food Bank, and the Children's Hospital and Medical Center. Josh Swain of Omaha took a year to prepare and competed in an epic duel of rock, paper, scissors, best of three. They tied three times straight, but the original Josh Swain emerged victorious.
As my brother, we did a great movie together. And on that movie, he was just rising up as a star. His first album didn't even come out yet, but he knew his journey was starting. We stood outside the Tunnel nightclub about to shoot a scene, and he looked at me and tears in his eyes because he knew about the journey he was about to embark on becoming a hip-hop icon. I want to say my condolences to my brother DMX family, to all his beautiful kids, to Yonkers, to Rough Riders, Swiss Beats, D.Y., Eve, Lox, the whole family, Drag On, everybody.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Episode 23 of the Minority Agenda Podcast. I'm your host, Isaiah Thornton. We had an amazing weekend, folks. We really did. It was truly beautiful. April 24th. I will never forget April 24th. I can't. It was one of those days that you just got to be like, you know, where was I when this happened? But first, let me introduce my two co-hosts, my two great co-hosts. You know, these guys, I really appreciate them and everything that they do. And, they always hone it down. So I don't know if they're hearing feedback. I see Ricardo shaking his head, but
no feedback. Good.
All right, I'm good. All right. So to my left, we have the hip hop encyclopedia himself, Mr. Mexicano, Mr. Ricardo Mexicano. He is one half of the Luchador tag team known as Minority Agenda, Mr. Ricardo Mexicano.
Yo, yo, yo.
All right.
Baby R.
Baby R in the building. You got 30 more seconds on the beat. And we got
and more tune for your head top. So watch how you speak on my name. You know.
You know this guy. You know this week. This guy. He didn't call. He didn't call Joe Biden. He didn't call Greg Abbott. This guy called Nas and said, "Nas, I want you to go up there and make a very public speech. I want you to say you had the greatest movie of all time with DMX and just let it ride. Let it ride." Mr. Jacob Gray, man, how you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Fantastic. How are y'all?
We were 3 minutes in. Now we gotta start the whole thing over. No, I'm kidding. Welcome to episode 23 of the Minority Agenda Podcast. Like I said,
see, there you go.
Right. I contradicted myself. Wow. But like I said, this weekend that we had was very, very, very good. I know we've been gone for 2 weeks, really like a week and a half. Excuse me, folks. I'm watching the Indiana's Pacers game right now. But over the weekend, we've been gone last week. What we missed was the Derek Chauvin verdict for George Floyd. That was very big, especially where I'm, where what city I'm in right now at in Houston. George Floyd grew up around three blocks from where I stay. You know, not even.
Yeah, his like memorial. It's not too far from there, right?
No, it's not too far. Then he has a street in front of his high school, in front of Yates High School. That's like I could drive to Yates in like 30 seconds. It, you know, just very important. That was a very important day. And then, of course, I want to say RIP to Black Rob, Shock G, and Micaiah Bryant. Also, Dante Wright. I don't want to forget about Dante Wright and Micaiah Bryant. You know, when you find out good news on Wednesday, you also have troubling news following. So, but I didn't want to start on a sad, somber note. Let's be positive. Let's be great. Let's be thankful. This is episode 23 of the Minority Agenda Podcast. So let's start with the weekend. The weekend consisted of a Josh fight, DMX memorial, which, you know what, if there's any, let's start with DMX's memorial, and we'll save the Josh fight for later because, of course, it's really funny and fun. I appreciate it. So I appreciate stuff like that. The DMX memorial, fantastic. I didn't know it was going to be, well, I knew it was going to be this big, right? I think we all had this feeling. But I didn't know they were going to bring out a monster truck. I didn't know it was going to be 400, or not even 400, 1,000 people with motorcycle bikes. Like, it's like we're back in 2001. I appreciated the nostalgic about it, the nostalgic atmosphere about it. When they showed DMX and they showed his casket riding on the Brooklyn, is that the Brooklyn Bridge? That might have been the Brooklyn Bridge.
I think so.
Yeah, when he was riding on the Brooklyn Bridge, it was beautiful, man. I really appreciated stuff like that. So I'll let you two get in here because I've been talking for 7 minutes now. I'm timing myself. But, you know, when you intern for Ralph Cooper, you got to know how long you can talk. So shout out to Mr. Cooper. He's doing really good. Ricardo, man, what did you think about the memorial? Let's start with you.
I actually caught it late. I thought it was beautiful, you know, honoring, you know, one of the legends, one of the greats. But I didn't really know about it until I started seeing people post about it. Till it started trending. Didn't really know it was supposed to happen that day. So it kind of caught me off guard. But yeah, I thought it was great. You said that you really like Belly. You think it's one of the best?
I don't. I laugh at Belly. I just laugh when Nas said, like everybody else, Nas said, we made a great movie together. And a lot of people on Twitter was like, I don't know about great, but... Like, you know, it's certain things
that's,
I laugh
that's
at.
What I be saying because, yeah, because, like, when I go back, I remember watching that as a teenager and being like, oh, man, this is the best. Because this is when I first discovered Nas, and I was, like, at the height of my fandom, right? and I remember watching, thinking, like, oh, man, this is, like, a great, you know, gangster crime movie. This thing is amazing. It shot beautifully. Like, Hype Williams, you know, this was Hype Williams in his directorial debut, right? You know, because he had, you know, previously just done music videos at that point. And it's beautifully shot. Like, you know, you still go back and watch that. It's a very beautiful movie. The cinematography is amazing. But then you, like, really start paying attention to the story once you grow up, like, as an adult. And you're like, man, this thing is kind of, this thing is kind of boo-boo.
It's all over the place. There's a part in there.
It is. Like, the script is like, Nas is like, he's like trying to. He's with T-Bars, and they're finna move to Africa.
Yeah. Let's move to Africa. You had no toothbrush, you had no bags packed. I'm just like, okay. And then he started describing. Yeah, he started describing Africa, and I'm still looking at New York City. I'm like, all right, what is this?
Mm-hmm. You had the dude, and it's so weird because the dude that was like he was kind of like the middleman. He was like the plug for the big drug Jamaican kingpin guy.
Yes.
What was his name? The one that was in the banana.
I can't think of his real name, but he passed away about 2 years ago.
What was the point of him in the movie? Because there was really no point. They just kind of like showed him, ate the banana, and then he eventually died.
No, no, no. He has set them up. The dude that was eating the banana. Not the old man. The old man from Kingston, Jamaica passed away. The dude that you're talking about, he has set them up. That's why they killed him.
But the way they presented it was so weird. And that was freaking Met the Man, the one that set him up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So.
Yeah.
But
I don't know. Bentley, I love Bentley. Like I love the soundtrack. Like the Bentley soundtrack is still good to this day. I can still go back and listen to it. Amazing soundtrack. I mean, you knew it was gonna be amazing.
Right.
But the movie itself, not one of the DMX's best. I think he's better in Romeo Must Die. I think he's better in that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then we got Jacob on the line. We have Jacob on the line, right? We have Jacob on the line. Mm-hmm. Jacob's looking very confused. He doesn't know what's going on. How's Luca, man? Where's Luca at?
Nah, he just left, actually. His mom just came and got him. He was asleep. But, yeah, I'm same as Ricardo, man. Like, throughout the weekend, I'm working, so, like, I'm really not paying attention to my phone. But when I did get on my phone, I didn't know the memorial was happening that day. And I just saw all the people in the road. Like, it looked like thousands of people on the road for his memorial.
Yeah.
And, like, how many people attended the memorial?
He doesn't say. It was a private memorial.
Okay, that's what I thought. So you could I didn't think it was going to be, like, a big thing for, like, the public and everything.
Right. No, you could come out. The public could come out, but they weren't going to let them in. Because of COVID.
That's what I thought.
But I'll say this. The city of New York did a great job of blocking freeways off so his whole procession could happen like that.
Mm.
So they shut down interstates. They shut down streetways and all that to get to Barclays Center. He went from Yonkers to Barclays Center. If you look that up on Google Maps, folks, that is like 24 miles. But 24 miles in New York is like an hour with traffic. So if you could just imagine going 24 miles and you have the whole freeway to yourself and you're driving what? How fast can you drive with a casket, Jacob, on a monster truck? What is your estimate?
On a monster truck?
I'm thinking you're going to have to go pretty, like, funeral lines go pretty slow anyway, so they're probably going at least like
20, 30 miles an hour.
Maybe like 40.
Okay. Yeah, see? Like, it was, I mean, I watched it and I was just like, wow, man, this is something. This is something. It showed the essence of New York City. This is what, you know, when you think of New York City, that's what you think about. Surprisingly.
Yeah.
When you think of California, you think about bikers, and you know, but in Texas, I don't ever think about people riding bikes in Texas. When I think about New York, that's mm-hmm. what I think about. That's who I picture. DMX and all of Rough Riders.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, Dipset. For the funeral, or not the funeral, for the memorial service hosted by Kanye West, Kanye put on this whole presentation with his Kanye's
Sunday service.
I want to be frank with you right now. I've been boycotting Kanye since he said slavery was a choice.
2018.
I've been boycotting Kanye since he said that. Slavery was a choice. I'm glad you knew what year that was. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So I had no efforts. I've never listened to Sunday service. This is my first time listening to Sunday service. When I finally sat down and listened to Sunday service, because of course I'm going to show respect to DMX. I'm not going to just change the channel because, oh, it's Kanye. I sat down. I listened. It was beautiful. It was really great. I really appreciated it. Am I going to go listen to Sunday service again? No. The boycott goes back up. The boycott goes back up. But you know what, Kanye? Thank you. I appreciate you. I'm going to give you a round of applause if I had my clapping things on here anymore, but I don't have them anymore. So,
okay.
Yeah, no, but Kanye did a really great job. I think everybody did a really great job. The Barclays Center, all that. You know, I'm talking like I'm in there. They said Jay-Z and Beyonce were there. I don't know if that's true or not. That I'm just hearing rumors. I appreciate anytime Hov comes out, but I think Hov might have been there.
Was the memorial service held in the same venue in the Barclay?
No, the homecoming,
you know, yeah, the homecoming.
They switched date, you know. So the homecoming was on Sunday. It was at an actual church. I don't know what church it was.
Okay.
But no, that I didn't watch because it was Sunday, and plus I didn't know how long it was going to be. It turned out to be like 4 hours and 4 hours and 30 minutes long.
Yeah, you sent that link, and I remember like checking that out like maybe 2 hours later, and it was still going on.
Yeah. That is the link I sent. You're right. I sent both links on 2 days, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I sent both links for both live streams. But yes, you were right. That and you know what? That reminds me of Muhammad Ali's funeral. Muhammad Ali's funeral was like 6 hours. I tried to sit up there and watch Muhammad Ali's funeral. I fell asleep. Couldn't do it. Really couldn't do it. Now, there's one incident that did happen that I caught this while watching live. DMX's friend, Jungle. I'm not here to bash Jungle. I'm not here to laugh at Jungle. I'm going to play the audio because I feel his pain. I don't know what it's like to be cut out of a funeral or funeral program, excuse me. And it's just, you know, because I had to call somebody. Of course, I called my mom. I was like, yo, mom, you think this is disrespectful? And she was like, yeah, you gotta do by the family's wishes. So let's play this audio. Again, we're not here to bash Jungle. I really think he just had an emotional breakdown and said, you know what? If y'all not gonna let me speak, I'm gonna speak myself. So here we go.
I too am Earl's best friend. And we've been on the road with him for the last couple of years. And this album would have not happened if we were not around. If we did not suffer through the pandemic and take Earl Simmons out of his house, drive an RV down south, and complete this album. I've been his friend for 20 years. 20 years I've been his friend, and I've been around him. I'm not an industry dude, and we got similar stories. Just like him with his grandmother, I have a grandmother that raised me, and I love my grandmother. I have a dog. I have similar stories. We both were in institutions when we were young. And I want to give you a story to how our lives paralleled and crossed each other. Tashira said something here tonight that struck me, and I never knew it. She said that she seen X steal a purse or a pocketbook. That's the same thing I did as an adolescent when I was about 9 to 10 years old. And that put me in the group home in Yonkers. That's how I ended up in Yonkers. So I knew Earl Simmons since 89. And he was 7 years my senior. But I was a fan of his before he even realized it, because he was a local hero in the music industry, in the music scene as an underground artist. He did shows at School 12 and in Commerce, and the group home was right next door to Commerce. And I'm gonna tell you something else. This last year of my life, all the time I know Earl, I never said this to him, but I told him a story that happened to me, and he was a part of that story. He was a part of that story. And my name is Jungle, by the way. So I'm letting y'all know for the ones that don't know me. All right.
Here's what I'm going to do, brother. Brother? My brother.
Over here. Yeah. Over here, my brother. First of all. No. There's order. There's respect. You violated order.
There is respect.
But you disrespected my house. You've disrespected my house.
What you telling me?
Regardless of how good you think what you got to say is, you disrespected my house. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother.
So at the end, Jungle said he wouldn't have had his last album if it wasn't for me and Craig. And Craig, he's talking about Craig Borehead. I think that is DMX's manager.
No, Scott Rifkin is DMX's manager.
Okay, so who is Craig Borehead?
I can't remember.
You don't care? Okay, well, one of DMX's associates. Because I've seen them. I've seen them in photos together. I have seen them in photo. All three of them in photos together. And so they said they helped DMX. They drove him to Atlanta. I don't know if it was the Pop Smoke feature. It was one of the songs that they were trying to get him back on the album. But What you guys take on this, man? Being cut out of a program. Let's start with Jacob. Jacob looks lost, but he looks like he's seen this before. Like,
no, I'm looking up the guy, the Craig guy.
Okay, Craig.
What's his last name?
Borehead, Borhead. Well, then let's go with Jacob while you look that up. I mean, let's go with Ricardo while you look that up.
Oh, I really appreciate the sentiment. Like, I thought it was, you know, completely honest. It came from the heart. Like, he sounded 100% genuine. And you said he was actually on the program, but I guess maybe he just showed up at the wrong time.
No, he said he was on the program, and then he said he got cut out of the program.
So he was on it originally, and then
right,
he found out after the fact that he was off of it.
I believe so, because when he popped up on screen, they were already doing, the pastor had just said, we're finna do the benediction.
Oh, so they like cut him out, and he was probably like confused. He was probably like, oh wait, I'm supposed to speak.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. They had already got to this was at the end, you know, the benediction is the last thing. They right. said, he said, we're finna do the benediction, and he just popped up on screen, and BET was like, you know, BT wasn't going to cut away if somebody's at the microphone. They're not going to, they right. can't cut off his mic. So, you know, stuck in a rock in a hard place. So,
yeah.
For me, again,
It's tricky.
Very tricky. For me, I was just like, I understand it, bro. I understand it. I get it. You want to say something to my last, you know, yeah, I get it. I understand it. I'm not mad at you. If I was here, I would have said, let him speak. You know, if I was living, I would have said, let him speak. But since mm-hmm. I wasn't, and my family asked, hey, all my kids are here, because he did this in front of all the kids, too. I just think maybe that wasn't the moment. But, you know, you can't tell people what they shouldn't and should not do when they're in pain or they're, you know, stressed out like that.
When they're grieving.
Yeah, when they're grieving. Thank you. Yeah. That's the word grieving. So, Jacob, any luck on Craig Borehead?
Yeah, so it said he was a part of DMX's management team and a friend of DMX for over 30 years. And I look at his credentials. He's worked with DMX, Jadakiss, Styles P, just a couple other just artists. But he's worked with a lot of artists since the early 2000s.
Okay.
A lot of Rough Rider stuff. Yeah.
A lot of Rough Riders. Yeah. I didn't play Swiss Beats stuff because one, it was like 2 minutes long. The other reason was Swiss Beats basically told people, go get you a will and make sure you have people. So, you know, so all this situation can be handled. I wouldn't be surprised if DMX didn't have a will. So, but again,
yeah.
Great. That was a great moment for that Saturday. I was on my couch from, it started at 5:15 to about 8 o'clock. And then of course on Sunday it was 4 hours long, but I didn't watch on Sunday until that ending with Mr. Jungle. Moving on.
You bring up the will. Mm-hmm. What age do you sit down and say, I have to write my will? Because X was 50?
Yes.
Yeah.
So when do you write? Because 50 is like, I mean, you're 50 is the age you're probably getting at where you're thinking about writing your will, but have you already written it?
In X's case, if I'm a multimillionaire.
Multimillionaire, you're right, yeah.
Recording artist, I would do it at 35.
So yeah. You think Drake already did as well?
He should have, yes. Is Drake 35?
I think he's like 34. So, yeah.
He's around that. Okay. Yeah. Drake should, after what album was that? I think after Views, Drake should have had his will.
Most people don't, though. That's something that nobody really ever thinks about. Now, I feel like down to regular people to probably the most famous.
Right.
You know, unless you have like your team around you. A will is something that never really comes into consideration for a lot of folks until like the very, very end.
I think maybe you would think of a will probably when you have a kid. Like once you have a child, you're like, all right, like in case anything mm-hmm. happens to me, I need to let the like know my kid is in good hands. My kid will be good.
Right.
Well, that's a question for you. Okay, so you just had baby Luca. Have you thought about this will? Because right as of right now, you don't have anything to give him. So, no.
No, I haven't thought about it. I probably won't think about it with will probably until, like you said, probably 35 for another 10 years.
Okay. So, I mean, yeah, I say 35. I think 35 is a nice – 35 is either that's when you're starting your career or – should already be in it. Something like that. Something to it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I want, you know, maybe for Rough Riders, I don't know, maybe, I guess, you know, they were young back then. Now that they're all older and DMX was the first one to go, they call can probably get arranged with all that type of stuff. Like Eve's going to be set for life. Eve is going to be fine. Swiss Beats is going to be fine. Dragon should be fine. A few of them should be fine in there in that camp.
Last question before we move on from the Will stuff.
Go ahead.
Do you think like artists from like Chicago, like Dirk and Herbo and Keith, who are from there and like have kids now, have wills because they've seen everything that happened to their friends?
I don't.
You know, none of them do.
No, because
I think they do.
I personally don't because I don't think they had anybody older telling them that type of stuff.
Yeah, I think you're right, too. I don't think they do have old heads around them.
Right. That's what I'm saying. I don't think they have no old heads telling them, hey, get you a will. Now, they had everybody to tell them to move out of Chicago, but a will? No.
Yeah.
Once they made it out of Chicago, that was their will. That's how I feel.
I think maybe now they do. I feel like, especially Keith and Dirk, they've been out of Chicago long enough to probably have something like that arranged for them now.
The only person... Dirk, oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was going to say, Dirk has been down in Atlanta for a while. Keith has been in L.A. for like a while. And so is... I think G Herbo stayed in L.A., I think, too. So yeah. I feel like they've been out for a while. I feel like stuff like that has probably been taken care of by management or, you know, part of the label, somebody.
The only person I think honestly, truly has a will from Chicago, like of that generation, might be Lil Bibby. I think Lil Bibby is the, you know, the cultivator. Like, hey guys, we should probably get this.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if he told that to Juice WRLD, but hey, we should all sit down and write this.
Yeah,
because Bibby's more in that executive seat. You know, he's been that boss, you know, CEO type of mode for a minute now.
All right, so let's see. We're 30 minutes in or 28 minutes in, almost 30 minutes. Just a quick note, I do want to announce this. Did you guys know that Mo3 second killer has been apprehended?
I saw that.
And what did I say in the group chat, Ricardo? What did I put verbatim in the group chat?
That this was over a female.
A woman. This is over a woman.
Yes.
90% of beef start over women, especially in Dallas, Texas. So, I don't want any credit. I don't want any type of award. I'm just saying this clears the name. This clears the name for a lot of rappers. We got to be honest right now. Clears the lane for a lot of rappers. But
Yeah,
that again, that is sad. You're right. That's sad to report. But 90% of women are the causes of beef. And I'm not going to say that she caused it herself. But just that man mad over that situation. And, hey, it happens.
Killer, by the way. Alleged killer. We still don't know.
You already been charged.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean you're convicted.
Sentence.
Yeah, you're missing. Yeah, you're still alleged. Right. You're about, you know, according to the law, you're still an alleged, you know, whatever until you're convicted.
What was next on your list? I know, I had Moneybagg you on there, but
yeah. Oh, you want to talk about the Josh fight first? Just kind of lining up the mood.
Yes, let's go to the Josh fight. This is the greatest fight of all time. WrestleMania has nothing on this fight.
Nothing. UFC 82, whatever number they're on now.
I think it's like nothing. It should be two. No, it's 261. They keep changing the numbers.
I don't know. I lost track a long time ago.
Yeah, they stopped going to order a long time ago. Dana White really makes me mad about that. Like, we should be at like number 400 by now. But go ahead, Josh fight. So the way this fight started was Josh Swan of Arizona sent out, or this happened over the pandemic. Over the week or over the pandemic, mm-hmm. he sent out a group message on Facebook of all the Joshes, all the Josh Swans with his same name, or just people named Josh mm-hmm. in general, added them all to a group chat and said, a year from now, we're going to have a fight for the name, for the naming rights of Josh. And I thought that was great. I thought it was funny. And people actually took seriously. They took it seriously. People have been training for a Josh fight for 1 year, and it ended up being a Josh noodle fight.
Yeah.
A Josh noodle fight.
The swimming.
The swimming noodle.
The pool noodle thing, right? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The swimming noodles. And, hey, man.
Yeah.
America. You know, sometimes people.
America.
Sometimes people amaze you. Because think about this. This ended up being in Lincoln, Nebraska, in a cornfield.
Bro. What has happened in Lincoln, Nebraska since this is like the most exciting thing to happen in Lincoln, Nebraska in a long time.
Since they played in a national championship game.
Yeah.
The last time.
Yeah, since the Cornhuskers, yeah, played in the game, yeah.
Oh, my God. Do you think the people in Lincoln, Nebraska are like, what are all these people doing here? Like,
yeah, they're probably like, what has happened to our town? What are these ruffians doing in our town?
So you know what I want to plan? I want to plan a Ricardo fight.
A Ricardo fight?
Yeah, in Tyler, Texas. How many people do you think would show up to Tyler, Texas for a Ricardo fight?
I know a few Ricardos in Tyler, and there's a lot more, of course.
Like, I know there's at least like what 10 or 15 Ricardos in Tyler. 20.
Maybe, I don't know.
But where could they have the fight at? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Lindy Park.
Is that the biggest park in Tyler?
Oh, pretty much. Just, yeah. Yeah, Lindsay. Yeah.
Lindsay Park. Have I been to Lindsay Park? I'm trying to think. Where is it located?
Yeah, where's Lindsay Park?
It's
at?
It's on 69 headed towards Chandler.
Ricardo, I don't like those type of people. Like, that's probably like northern type of people who just give like street names. Like, give me a place where it's near. Like, it's near this Walmart. We're from Texas.
It's
we're
not from, near.
Me and I are
it's
black.
It's not near Colorado. Walmart.
Is it by Texas?
But you
gotta
give where it's near something. That's how black people. I can like, oh, it's near this.
It's on. The it's north not side near or anything. It's on north side or south side.
It's like. It's all technically the north side because you're heading towards Chandler.
You talking about that park? Talking about that park by Tyler Lee?
No. No, no, no. This is nowhere near. This is nowhere near the city. It's kind of outside the city limits.
Oh, okay, okay.
What's that? It's like if you're on the loop, right?
Yeah.
And you were heading to like if you're passing all the car dealerships, you know all
I
the
know
car.
Which one you're talking about now,
right? Yeah. And then you eventually hit a light, and yeah, on one of those lights,
right.
You take a right. Yeah, and you head all the way down, and you eventually hit the park. Yeah, that one right there.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, we're gonna have a Ricardo fight. We should probably
not have a Ricardo fight.
We should do a UT Tyler, definitely UT Tyler.
UT Tyler?
Yeah, they
would you have a Ricardo fight? You just do it with noodles, like the same thing.
Oh no! This is really with fists.
Just bare bone, bare fist.
I want violence at the Ricardo fight. Could you imagine 1,000 Ricardos show up?
Just stealing off on each other, left and right, left and right.
Okay, but
getting kicked in the ribs.
Yeah, no, Jake. Did we get Jacob's take on the Josh fight?
I was just gonna say it's really wholesome too. I was like, you know, out of all the stuff that's been happening, you know, here lately in the news, it was really nice and wholesome to see something like this happen. And remember, little Josh won, the little kid. He's the one that won.
Josh was like this little Josh was like 4 years old and he was black. Shout out to Josh beating all the white folks. Yeah. from the Minority of the
Minority of the Yeah, shout out Lil Josh.
Shout out Lil Josh. Yeah.
Was there any Spanish Joshes there?
In Lincoln, Nebraska? Huh? I don't know if that's a safe place for
Josh. That showed up.
I don't know. Maybe.
Because I know Josh is like a multi-race name, but I didn't know if it's a Spanish name too.
Yeah. I think I met like some Hispanic kids named Josh. I'm pretty sure I have. Yeah.
Because I know like Chris and Alex. That's like an Eric.
Yeah. Pretty that's common. Like yeah.
Yeah. It's common for like all races. But I was just wondering if Josh was too.
Yeah. All right. What we got next? Something that, I know Isaiah is probably going to be very interested in it.
What am I interested in?
Let me hear something that he loves. A national hero in his eyes.
National? Wait, can I guess?
Yeah, you can try.
Are they black or white?
They're black.
They're black. What state are they from?
Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about.
A national hero. Pennsylvania.
Yeah, of yours.
Of mine. Oh man. Yeah.
Wait, it came to my mind when Isaiah said black or white. And then I was like, why would you have a white hero? And then when I said that, I'm like, oh, I know who it is now.
Oh, wait. Well, he's not a national hero of mine, but I mean he's you know what, he's a really top dog. I had to think about it. You talking about Dr. Umar? Yeah, it's Dr. Umar. It got to be Dr. Umar.
Dr. Umar Abdullah Johnson, a.k.a. Jermaine Shoemake.
Is his name Abdullah for real?
Yeah, well, his real name is Jermaine Shoemake before he changed the name to Umar Johnson.
My friends are upset at Dr. Umar because they say he keeps changing the name of his school every interview. He's been doing this for 6 years, and he's been changing the name of that school every time he does an interview.
The reason.
Oh. Okay, so what happened? Yeah, go ahead. Tell me what.
No, nah, I mean, so for the fifth time, I think this is, Umar Johnson has appeared on The Breakfast Club, and, you know, as per usual, he was going to give out his usual lunatic commentary on certain things.
Yeah,
and get the get the Twitter spear, you know, up in a riot, you know, a lot of support for him, but also a lot of backlash, like always. Mm-hmm. What did you think of the interview?
I thought it was
as a whole.
I thought this might have been his funniest interview.
You know why though?
Why? Because Charlamagne or?
I think it is the first time where he embraced like all the memes. Where he talked about it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, you're right. You might be right about that.
Previously, he had been like kind of like I'm pretty sure he knew about him, but he didn't like really like mention it. And this is like the first time where he was like, "Oh yeah, I know what y'all are doing." Because he gave that whole little like speech where he was like, "I think it's funny, but I don't like it when y'all I feel like the memes kind of subvert away from the message and all that he was talking about."
Yeah, I'm listening. I'm watching Eric Little dunk on somebody. Oh my god.
Yeah.
once you live on the internet for so long, you're gonna get memed on. Like,
yeah.
Like everybody gets memed on.
Like, don't get me wrong, man. As much as I have a dislike for Umar, the memes are funny. You know, I follow shout out to No Context Umar Johnson on Twitter. Like, I follow the page. You know, when they just be posting like the random clips of like Umar just saying the most wildest thing with no context.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I appreciate it.
You know, but some of his points.
I have like.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead, Jacob.
Oh, no, you go on. Zay.
No. Because I was going to like kind of bring like a serious topic, but I'll let you go first.
I was about to say like most of my video memes are Umar, like just like saying like wild, outlandish stuff. Like I love his like memes. His memes are always like some of the funniest. Like him, Stephen A. Smith, Soulja Boy has great memes. Just like them are like the mm-hmm. perfect meme masters. Like they don't even mean to do it, and they do it.
No, they're not even trying. That's the thing.
No, that's why it's perfect.
I love you brought up Stephen A. Smith, and I love the One of my favorite from him is the, like, you know what? We don't care. I love that one. We don't care.
Yeah. And I think for me, but on a serious note, in his interviews, when he was talking about the HBCUs and African-American studies, Texas Southern, the school I go to, they did make you take that class. You had to take African-American studies as a English course. Wasn't as a history course. It was as an English course. And then, of course, you had they taught me Texas history. They taught Texas history here. So to his point about some of that stuff, it is true. Texas Southern still does it. I mean, they're still holding up to their namesake and to what they want to teach the students. Other schools might have changed their outlook on stuff, you know, when it comes to teaching African-American studies and all that type of stuff. So, yeah, he does have a point on some of that stuff. I won't.
You took that class, Zay?
Yeah, I had to. It's required.
For everybody?
Oh yeah, it's required for everybody.
Oh, okay.
So you
because
take
because I would love to have taken that class at UNT. But I took African American anthropology, and that was just as good. Mm-hmm. I mean, I probably would have got more out of like studies rather than just straight anthropology. Mm-hmm. But I was a social science minor, so that's why I took that class.
Right. No, I had it's required, and then they made it. Of course, they made it an English course. So you take English 1, English 2, and then that's technically like your English 3. They just don't say mm-hmm. it, but mm-hmm. it's it counts as an English credit. It's like a third English credit or whatever.
So, I wish they would like do that for every college in America.
No, it was a great class. I had a great teacher. My teacher was very, very pro. He wasn't Umar to Umar's effect, but he was damn near close.
That's how my teacher was for anthropology. Yeah. She was in that. She was in it.
And so, you know, we had and then of course our school is like the most diverse HBCU. So we have white kids, Latino kids in the class, and you know, he showed them with nothing but the utmost respect. Like, hey, like, you know, you guys are learning about our culture. And then he would always ask them about their culture and just, you know, make it a whole cultural thing. Something else that Umar said about, I'm not going to talk about the Naomi Osaka because it is what it is. Naomi Osaka, she's representing Japan, but she is black. I'm just saying. I understand.
She is.
I get it why she's doing it. I have no problem with her representing Japan or whatever. Not Haiti.
If you want to get into that topic, it's the same thing with like Rui Hachimura, if you know who he is on the Washington Wizards. Like, he's black in Japan, but he represents Japan more than his black side.
I don't see what's wrong with that.
Yeah, and it's like when he started talking about that, I started thinking about all these like black, like let's say like French players who are black, you know, they grew up in France, who happen to play basketball, mm-hmm. Or from Europe, from Germany, whatever, happen to play basketball, come to the States, you know, they play in the NBA. But when it's time for like when it's time for FIBA, they're representing, you know, their home country. I mean, even though their parents may be from Cameroon or Nigeria, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, it's the same thing. Like, you grew up in France, you grew up in Germany, you happen to be black, but you're still representing the country. Like, I get it.
Yeah, same. So, that's like, I mean, it's just, why do you have to pick and choose? Like, some people like with me, with being black and white, I'm not going to choose like, hey, if there was this, I'm not going to choose this side or that side. I know, like, I don't want to get into that topic because that's just a whole another rabbit hole to get down.
No, I understand.
I think it ultimately is what is much closer to you. Not saying that one is better than the other, but like, but for instance, if she happened to grow up more in like Haiti, and spend most of her time there, but then she decided to still go represent Japan, and that would be a little fishy. You know, that could be a little questionable. But she has her roots in Japan. You know, she grew up there. So I get her choice at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Listen, Naomi Osaka is dating a rapper. She doesn't have to prove how black she is to me, all right? She's dating a rapper. Hey, if YBN, or he's not even YBN Cordae anymore. If Cordae.
It's just Cordae.
It's Cordae, right? I hate it so much. It's, you know, it's YBN Cordae. I don't care what anybody says. If YBN Cordae asked Naomi Osaka, if he wasn't successful, and he asked Naomi Osaka, hey, can you put a lien on your house to help me do this record deal? And she doesn't listen. She here, all right? She black. If she was out here, yeah. If she was shouting out Cordae's mixed or SoundCloud mixtape after every interview, every time she won a tennis tournament, hey, man.
Yeah.
So she don't have to prove how black she is to me. She's dating a rapper. She wears the headdresses. She wears the African attire. I understand it. I get it. I love it. Now, gentlemen, we are 45 minutes into our 60-minute show. I'm making it 60 minutes because I don't know. I'm honestly hungry. honestly, I'm hungry.
Yeah.
What else is on our list? We have Moneybagg Yo. We have other stuff on our
list. Oh, yeah, Moneybagg Yo. I haven't heard the album, but you say you love it.
Listen, Moneybagg Yo hasn't given me a bad song in a long time. Like, when I first heard Moneybagg Yo, I was in Tyler. And this is before he, you know, blew up. This is like his first mixtape.
Yeah.
And it was really good. Really good. And he's kept that same attitude towards every record that he puts out. He puts his heart and soul into it. And really good. His intro starts with Cash Page. Do you know who Cash Page is out of Dallas?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, his intro starts with her. Pretty good. Pretty good intro. And then you got songs like Whoa Keisha. You got his best song on there is like the fourth or fifth song. I can't think of the title right now, but that is a crazy song. He has a feature with Dirk and Polo G. You know that. Listen, go listen to this Moneybagg Yo project. I promise you, you'll like it. And yeah, that's really my music take this week. I don't know if there's any new music coming out. Jacob, do you have that pulled up? Or Ricardo? It looks like Ricardo's searching something.
Yeah, I was going to say, is he still signed to CMG? He's still under Gotti?
He should be, yes. I believe so.
Okay.
I believe
so. New music coming out? I don't know. I think Billie Eilish is supposed to come out with a new album that I'm looking forward to.
She's from the UK, right?
Nah, she's from California.
She's from California? Oh, yeah. Never thought. What happened to Lorde? Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking of. What happened to Lorde?
She's from New Zealand. I don't know what happened to her.
Okay, Lorde made Royals, and then Rick Ross remixed Royals, and we've never seen her again.
Yeah, I like Billie Eilish. Yeah, I think she's great. I think she has a lot of potential. I mean, she already proved herself, so I just can't wait to see what else she has in store. I don't see anything new upcoming right now. I can't find a good list. But I know Slime Language 2, the deluxe edition dropped.
Okay. Oh, and shout out.
Cool, Slime Language.
And shout out to Young Thug and Gunna. Over the weekend, they bailed like 30 people out.
30?
Yeah, like 30 people out of, it's not Cook County Jail. I don't know the jail name.
Fulton County Jail.
Thank you. Fulton County Jail in Atlanta. They bonded 30 people out so they could go be with home with their families. I had one thing that I was going to say before that, and it was really, really important. Oh, have you guys seen Mortal Kombat? I have not seen it yet.
I still haven't. I need to catch it this week.
You haven't. Neither one of you have. Okay, so does anybody in here have HBO Max?
Yeah, I do.
You do. Does it give you a free trial? Because I'm trying to finesse. I'm trying to finesse a free trial out of HBO Max.
I think it does.
Oh goodness, that's not helping me. I don't want to give them $15.
Look it up.
I looked it up. I tried. It said subscribe, and we're gonna charge.
Oh wait, what did you ask? Ian? I was reading through news.
Does HBO Max have a free trial?
Oh. I don't know. Well, yeah, I mean, Laura has HBO Max, so I watched it on there.
I get it for free.
For what?
Because I have AT&T.
I thought you could, because you're a veteran. I thought that was your...
No, AT&T comes included with a free HBO Max.
You know, we got 10 minutes on the show. Are you still using your veterans discount, man? Yeah, man. What's up with you, man? You still use your veterans discount?
Oh, when I can. Like, especially when... some places offer it year-round. So, like, for example, you know, Firehouse subs?
Yeah.
So, like, when I go there, and I'll be in uniform, like, I'll go for lunch. They'll I mean, yeah, because it's just my lunch break. So, I'm just, you know, I'm heading off a base right quick, and I just come right back to the office. But they'll take a discount off, like 10% off every time you go in automatically.
Oh, so you don't wear the actual veterans hat that the old, you know, like the old veterans wear. You don't wear that hat and just show up and just try to.
The legal definition to be a veteran in the military is 4 years of honorable service.
Really?
And you're considered a veteran at that point.
Don't you have to show the card? That's what I thought.
No. If you're in uniform, that's all you need. But if you're out of uniform, yeah, you need to show the card.
Yeah, because whenever they have a veteran's discount, my dad whips out that card real quick.
So you never showed, so Ricardo, you've never just shown up to Razoo's and just like slapped your card on the table, just boom.
I don't even know if they offer a veteran's discount
at Razoo's.
Hey, sometimes you gotta try it though.
Yeah, you gotta try it.
Sometimes you do, like don't get me wrong, like I've been to like pre-COVID when we could like actually go out and like eat at like restaurants. I remember we would go somewhere, like a group of us, for lunch or whatever, and then like there'll usually be somebody there who will like eventually like come over to your table, like some random like person in the restaurant, to be like, hey you guys, I got it, you know, don't worry about it. And they will like get everybody's lunch, you know? Like that happens.
For real?
Somebody that actually happens. Yeah.
That's crazy. I didn't think that. Yeah. That's some good people.
Yeah.
Lastly, folks, I want to say this because my friends think I'm crazy. I want to go against Aaron Donald for a whole series. Do you know who Aaron Donald is?
Yeah, go against him for what?
No.
In pads, I want to be fully padded up, and I want to face Aaron Donald one-on-one.
Look, Ricardo, look up Aaron Donald. Like look up him just like... Like
I'm guessing he's a football player.
He's a football player, yes.
Yeah.
Who did he play for?
The Rams. He's a three-time defensive player.
Right now, Ricardo. Yeah. If I was in pads and he wasn't even in pads and he'll run me over, I'll probably die.
See, you
You're
think
die.
That
You're
no
explode on impact.
I have enough confidence in myself. Me. I have enough confidence in myself that I think I don't care what man it is, I can beat him. From Aaron Donald, Conor McGregor, Mike Tyson, Ray Lewis.
He would kill me, but he might put you in the hospital for a couple of weeks.
Listen, so you don't think I can block him for one series? This is four downs.
No.
I can't block him for four downs?
No.
Why not?
He's going to run you over each time, Isaiah. And you will be in the hospital with a concussion, some broken ribs. You ain't going to be able to move the bottom half of your body anymore. You'll be moving your neck like this, I swear.
Listen, I want to be in the Aaron Donald realm. I want to face Aaron Donald. Everybody's showing me all these videos. Oh,
why?
Well, you know he practices with knives. I don't care. He practices his
Go ahead. They say that he's one of the greatest defensive players of all time. Why do you want to do that?
Why? Because of pros versus Joes. They need to bring back pros versus Joes. I would like to face
on Spike TV.
Yes, on Spike TV. I would like to face Aaron Donald. I think I can do it. I can block him for four downs. Four downs. That's all I'm asking. I'm not saying a full game. I'm not saying a full game. I'm not saying a full quarter. If I'm fully padded and he's fully padded, give me four downs. I promise you, my quarterback doesn't get sacked. He didn't get touched. Jacob's face right now is
he's
great.
Sending you flying to Venus.
Each time he's running you over, he's chucking you each time.
Bro, you get in lost to Saturn.
I swear.
You're going to get sent to orbit.
There's some NFL players who play against him who get trucked each time.
Yeah, that's them. They not me. They not Isaiah. They not Zay. They not me. They not Zay got it.
When it comes to the NFL, no. I think I probably can.
No.
I mean, I probably couldn't do any like anything comparable to them, like going against them. But when it comes to like maybe MLB or like NBA, I think I could handle somebody. But NFL ain't no way. Them some dogs in the NFL.
They big.
Yeah.
I keep saying one last thing. Also, we have the NFL draft this week. Me and Wilson and I guess I should announce this, right? Well, we're kind of a part of his new media venture. I don't know how to explain it. What's the name of it? Unfiltered Media Industries. I hate the name already. It's too long, but shout out to Wilson. look at me, right? Like, look at me trying to just... So, Wilson wants to start, like, a little... how do you say it? A YouTube channel / network, basically.
Yeah, I understand.
And so, we're trying... So, he has 4 people already, and he wants us to come on. You know, he wants Minority Agenda to be a part of it. Because he sees the great things that we're doing. And, of course, that's my boy. But I told him, hold on, man. I don't know, man. I said, listen, I got 30% stake. Ricardo got 30% stake. Jacob got 30% stake. Laura and Luca, you know, they got like 15 and 15. I might have to cut that pod, you know.
But that's like, that's.
I have to cut that part out, you know, so she didn't hear that. So, but, you know, hey, man, people got some stakes now. Yeah. I might have to cut that part out. But you know, yeah, so we're kind of a part of Unfiltered Media Industries in a way, not fully guaranteed yet. We haven't signed a contract and nothing like that. But we are having a fantasy draft watch party through Zoom, and we'll be live streaming. So if you guys are free Thursday, if you're free Thursday and you want to watch the draft, the NFL draft, I'll be here. I'll live stream it and all that. And I'm like, we're just doing our reactions and stuff.
Okay.
So let me know. I'll have wings. Of course, you can't get any wings because we're in three different locations. But
yeah.
I mean, I could if you send me some my way. You know, I got a Wingstop in Palestine.
I haven't been to Wings. Look, I stopped going to Wingstop, man. I don't do Wingstop no more. Hold on, real quick.
Where you go to get your wings then?
In Dallas.
Where you go?
When I'm in Dallas, I go to Wings over Siegelville, or I go to my new spot, Fry Daddy's. Fry Daddy's is in
the spot. They got a wings over in Siegelville?
Yeah.
Oh, Fort Worth just got one. They got a wing over Fort Worth over here now.
Wings over Siegelville is right next to the prison, the federal prison.
Oh, okay. I know what that is.
You know where it is? Off of 20, or not 20, it's like 30? Yeah. That's not 30. God,
60. I think it is 30.
67. Or something like that.
67? Okay. It's
like you that. Ever been to Pluckers?
Pluckers?
I still have never been. Is it as good as they say?
Yes. It's the best wings I've ever had from a restaurant. Or from fast food or restaurant, whatever you want to call it.
People keep telling me about American Deli, but I don't trust any place that says American Deli. I'm not trusting that.
I hear American Deli's good. Do they have one here in Texas?
Yeah, they have one. They have someone in Houston.
Okay. I know there's one in Atlanta.
Yeah.
But I never knew there was one here.
Yeah. I just found out my stepdad is in Atlanta for a business trip. Or whatever. And I was like, hey, tell them to go to Magic City to get some wings.
Some of them little wings.
Yeah, go get some little wings in Magic City. Get some wings. She's like, I'm not.
I really want to try them, hoes. I do really too. Do.
I want to try them. Well, it's not going to be 8 minutes long, obviously. That's like 2 minutes.
Nah.
So right now we have hit the 60-minute mark in like 20 seconds. I want to say special shout out to a whole bunch of people. I don't have any shout outs, but shout out to everybody. Shout out to Rebecca. Rebecca, how do you say her last name, Ricardo? Narahi?
Naheda.
Naheda?
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Rebecca Naheda from Rust, Texas. She is going to be moving to Oklahoma City. Yep. I've seen that post on Facebook. I'm on Facebook every now and then.
Hey, shout out to Rebecca.
I know Jacob's not, but she'll be working with the Oklahoma City Post. Is that? Am I wrong in that information?
No, she's going to be working with Report of America.
Okay. Well, I knew
it's
it was
like a, it's like a lot more independent.
So, you know, she'll be good. She does great stories. She does great stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think I still have Rebecca's number. I should probably call. But, man.
Yeah, she let me know about the news a few, like a week ago, but she had to keep it on hush, you know, until like so she got closer to the end of the month. So she gave me the scoop, you know, but I just, you know, obviously I couldn't tell anybody.
Look, Ricardo being the inside man. Like, okay. All right.
I'm saying.
All right. One last thing. Yeah, we're going to end on Shock G. RIP Shock G. This man discovered
him. Come on, yeah.
He discovered Tupac. There would be no Tupac without Shock G. I'll say that. But one last thing. I know, right? One last thing, Ricardo. DJ Mustard said he is now increasing his job to $7,000 a month. Are you going to be that man that steps
Stop
up?
It. I don't want to talk about this anymore.
Why you want to talk about it?
No, I don't care about Mustard like that.
Oh my goodness. Also, The Game is coming out with a new album called 30 for 30. I don't know what day it's coming out, but him and Wack 100 said they've been in the studio. So I'm excited. I've been excited for the past week and a half.
All that.
All right, but I'll let Ricardo tune us out, man. Jacob, you got anything else before we go?
And more tune for your head top, so watch how you
sound.
Okay. Go ahead, Ricardo. Take us away, man.
All right, man. Y'all know what it is. We're not black. We're not white. We're something in the middle. This has been the Minority in the Podcast, and we are out. Just watch me do the Humpty Hop. Yeah. Do you know what I'm doing? Doing the Humpty Hop. Come on. I do the Humpty Hop. I do the Humpty Hop. People say you're Humpty. You're really funny looking. That's alright, cause I get things cooking. You stare, you glare, you constantly try to compare me. But you can't get near me. I'm giving more Z and on the floor B. All the girls, they adore me. Oh yes, ladies, I'm really being sincere. Cause in the 69, my Humpty nose will tickle your rear. My nose is big. I'm not ashamed. Big like a pickle. I'm still getting paid. I get laid by the ladies. You know I'm in charge. Both how I'm living and my nose is large. I get stupid. I shoot an arrow like Cupid. I use a word that don't mean nothing. Like Luke did. I sang on Do What You Like. And if you missed it, I'm the one who said, just grab them in the biscuits. Also told you that I like to bite. Well, yeah, I guess it's obvious. I also like to...